call the Ramsey County Board of Commissioners meeting to order, please. Thank you. Roll call.
Carter? Here. Matas Castillo?
Here.
McGuire?
Here.
Ortega?
Aye.
Reinhardt?
Here.
McDonough?
Here. We'll stand for the Pledge of Allegiance, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Good morning.
Good morning.
First item is to approve the agenda for November 5th, please.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Roll call.
Carter?
Yes.
Matas Castillo?
Yes.
McGuire?
Aye.
Ortega?
Aye.
Reinhardt?
Aye.
McDonough?
Aye. Next item is to approve the minutes from October 22nd.
So moved. Second.
We got a motion and a second. Any corrections? Roll call.
Carter?
Yes.
Matas Castillo?
Yes.
McGuire?
Aye.
Ortega?
Aye.
Reinhardt?
Aye.
McDonough?
Aye. Our next item is a proclamation recognizing the 2019 Ramsey County Extension Farm Family of the Year, Commissioner Reinhardt.
Thank you.
And everybody that's here for that, come on up. Welcome.
And Tammy, you should be up here. We'll let you take a picture too.
Good morning.
Okay. Thank you. Well, I am really pleased to be here. I'm so happy. Commissioner McGuire and I are on the Extension Committee, and this is one of the most fun things that we do, the Extension Committee in general, but especially this, the Farm Family of the Year for Ramsey County, because oftentimes people don't think about Ramsey County and agriculture and food production when, in fact, we've got a lot going on here, and it's a tough competition every year. So I'm just really pleased to be here. So I will read the proclamation. Whereas Seeds of Hope Community Garden, located at the New Life Presbyterian Church in Roseville, is a three-part charter agreement of one-third New Life Presbyterian church members, one-third surrounding community non-church members, and one-third immigrant populations. You can tell already that this is a special place. And whereas the garden supports vegetable growing for about 28 people and their families, and whereas for more than a decade, garden plots have been rented by gardeners to grow their own vegetables, and there are designated food shelf plots for organizers to plant, grow, and deliver fresh vegetables to surrounding food shelves, which are managed by the participating gardeners and church volunteers. And whereas the garden does not use herbicides or pesticides, thank you, and limits use of fertilizers to only those that are approved by the Garden Coordinating Committee. And whereas Seeds of Hope Community Garden works with the Como Seed Library to host Seed Saver events and host several other community events throughout the growing season and an end-of-season potluck. Now, therefore, be it proclaimed that the Ramsey County Board of Commissioners, along with the Ramsey County Extension Committee, congratulate Seeds of Hope Community Garden in its selection as the University of Minnesota Extension's 2019 Farm Family of Ramsey County. And be it further proclaimed, the Ramsey County Board of Commissioners declares November 5th as Seeds of Hope Community Garden Day in Ramsey County. And I would like to say, well, some of the people that are up here with me, I know Nancy and Ken, but I don't know your last names. you can do that. Darby Lane, also present. Betsy Mowry is the chair of the Extension Committee. And Tammy McCullough is our staff person from the University of Minnesota. And everybody works together and works very, very hard on choosing the Farm Family of the Year. And it's always a special time. So I'd like to present this to Darby. Is that who? There you go. Thank you, Victoria. All right. Picture here. Wait a minute. Mary Jo's going to come in too.
Well, I want to get in one, but I want someone to take it then. Take it. With all of us in it, yeah.
Come on, you begin one. Yes.
Thank you.
Okay, yeah, maybe this is a little bit easier.
One, two, three. Oh, that's the best photo all year.
Did anybody want to?
Yes.
Great.
And if you'd like to say a few words, and Ken, what is your last name?
Kamau.
Kamau?
Yeah.
And Nancy?
Morchetto.
Okay, sorry I didn't get that before so I could introduce you properly. Go ahead, Darby.
Thank you. Thank you so much for the recognition and for having us here this morning with you. It's quite an honor for our garden. We've been in operation for about 10 years, and they've been 10 years labor of love. So every year, it's an amazing journey of community and experiences and wildlife. Believe it or not, I'm sure you know, there's quite a bit of wildlife in urban areas, and we get to encounter a lot of them. I think the biggest thing that, hopefully I speak for everyone in our community today, the importance of these gardens and the positive joy that they bring to the people that participate in them cannot be, I can't say enough about that, how important that is to the community, that we have 32 plots, but of those 32 plots, there's probably at least 2 to 3 gardeners working in each of those plots, plus their families that reap the benefits of that food. So in total, we're probably serving about 120 people with the food that's produced from the garden. And it's fresh produce. It's awesome and delicious and grown in Minnesota, and we're so proud of that. I also attended the Farm Fest this year, which for garden nerds, that's like, it was amazing and exciting. And the president of the University of Minnesota spoke at that event. And it was one of her first public appearances in her new role. So it was really fun to have her there, encouraging all of us, all of the farm families that are there. It was exciting to participate as a member of that community, being that I grew up in the city and did not grow up gardening, so, and know a lot about bees, but, so it was fun. So thank you very much for the honor and the opportunity to connect with so many more people that are doing what we're doing in our community. And yay.
They would prefer not to say anything, all right, that she's covered it all. So yep.
Couple of quick comments back. All of us are very involved in our state association and counties, and one of my proud moments always is talking about the originality and the creativity that we get to hear about what's going on in our community when we present Farm Family of the Year, right? Most of these counties outstate, it's about who's getting the biggest deal on corn or soybeans or milk or kind of your traditional farming, right? And there's nothing traditional about the families and individuals we recognize here at this meeting in the work that you're doing in our community, and that's really important, and it's really important to call out. So thank you for the work you do, and we're honored and proud to be able to recognize the work that you've done in our community for us.
Thank you.
Mr. McGuire.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I was greeting you earlier, and it's so fun to be on the Extension Committee, as Commissioner Reinhart said, and this is one of the really fun parts, is to actually go over the applications of the farm families and the people that are really doing such great work in, you know, urban, in our urban county, and it is exciting every year that we continue to have amazing organizations like yourself that are doing such great work for the people here and providing such great food. So thank you so much for your work.
Thank you.
All right. Our administrative items. Commissioner Carter.
Thank you. I'd like to move the following items on our agenda. That would be item number 6, number 7, number 8.
I'd like to pull number 8.
Number 9, 10, 11, 12. I'd like to pull number 13 and 14, 15, Are you pulling 15 or moving?
Actually, I can pull one of them because they can all be discussed at the same, but 13, 14, and 15 would be pulled.
All right.
16, 17, 18, 19, it's a long list today, 20, 21.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Roll call, please.
Carter?
Yes.
Matas Castillo?
Yes.
McGuire?
Aye.
Ortega?
Aye.
Reinhardt?
Aye.
McDonough?
Aye. All right. Item number 8 is from Social Services. Personnel complement increase in the Social Service Department. Do I have a motion?
So moved.
And a second?
Second.
All right. Thank you. And Ryan and Ann and a few folks are going to talk about this one here. So,
thank you, Mr. Ryan? Thank you, Mr. Chair. Commissioners, I'll invite Ann Berry, Interim Director of Social Services, up to say a few words. And as a lead-in to this, I'll just say this is a big deal. This is a good deal, but a big deal for all the right reasons. And Ann will tell you a bit more. But as we talk about the work we've done working with young people in the juvenile justice system, there's a bigger question about the social services system and the $20 million in child welfare and out-of-home placement, specifically in that area. This is a tangible move toward working to address some of the disparities and challenges that we have seen and law enforcement has seen alongside us in working in the child welfare system. And so I'd ask Director Berry to talk some about that and finish just by noting that we're going to have a conversation in quarter one of this coming year around the holistic approach to child welfare work and where we are headed with that. This is a tangible step in that direction, but a lot more to come.
Excellent. Ann, welcome.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the board. I am Ann Berry, the Interim Social Services Director, and I want to say just a few words about this proposal. Thanks, Ryan, for the introductory comments. As we dive into the work that we're doing in the child welfare programs and begin to understand all of our policies and practices, there was one that came to the front almost immediately. By listening to community, by talking with law enforcement, and by looking at the raw data, we could see that in St. Paul particularly, but throughout Ramsey County, particularly African-American and American Indian children are not only overrepresented in our system, but are overrepresented in the number of times law enforcement removes children from their families and takes them first to Children's Hospital, then to an out-of-home placement. So what we did with that listening we had with community, talking to law enforcement, and their agreement that, in fact, they're not in the best position to make a decision about what is safe for a child in a home where they have just been, you know, for whatever other reason they were in a family's home. And as I said, we're looking at the comparative data to other counties. We sat down with law enforcement and put together this proposal. Counties are required to have a 24/7 response, but our 24/7 response is, shall we say, buffered by overtime, staff currently in overtime, and a crisis contract that we use with other metro counties. What we said is we want to add these staff, 11 staff, 10 staff and a supervisor, who will co-respond with law enforcement. So in doing so, a child protection worker and a mental health worker will go at the time of the police call, and then they will take over the responsibility for making the decision about what happens with that child. So in many instances, we know that the child could stay at home, that the surroundings are still safe. There are times when we could reach out to relatives. So we will be the only county with a 24/7 face-to-face responsibility. I'm really proud of that, and I think we'll see big differences and big changes in the way we won't be placing as many children into the out-of-home care system or displacement from their homes.
Great. Good work. And maybe Ryan or Ann, you could just, even though we've approved number 9, there is a connection between number 9 and number 8.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So number 9 relates specifically to a cooperative contract in which Ramsey County has served as the fiscal agent for the 24/7 response system across the metro area. As Director Berry mentioned, in the changes to how we plan to do face-to-face interaction with staff in Ramsey County, it became advantageous to transfer the fiscal agent relationship to another county that will be more using the contract more often. And so I believe it's Hennepin County who's likely to assume the fiscal agent responsibility, but Ann's looking at me like that might not be true.
Mr. Chair, right, one question. Dakota County.
Oh.
Okay. No, it is Hennepin. Oh, you were right. I'm sorry, I was wrong. So,
as long as it's not us, we're good, right?
it's not us, that's the right response. It's Hennepin County, and yes, we've only signed this cooperative agreement. We only intend to be in for 6 months because of the overlap. This contract would start January 1st, or this cooperative agreement would start January 1st. We don't think we could, with your approval, and if we move ahead, we don't think we could get this up and running fast enough. So we need to stay in that contract for an extended period of time so that we can get staffed up and start doing the work that we want to do. So one other thing I should have mentioned, we've met with St. Paul Police, but I also wanted to tell you that I met with Chief Axtell 2 weeks ago, and he would have liked to have been here today to lend his support to this proposal because he thinks it's the right thing to do as well and puts his officers in the right place, right? Not making decisions that are really child protection decisions in nature, but co-responding with us is something he's very strongly in favor of doing.
Commissioner Mattis Castile.
Yes, thank you. I just want to applaud your work and our innovation around this, and I'm glad that you brought up the working with law enforcement, because this helps our officers immensely, as well as our families and our children, and so having that partnership and cooperation is really a great step forward, and I applaud you for your work, and that we're really working to prevent that displacement for children and the stress and trauma of whatever that event that occurs. So thank you for that work, and thanks to your staff and all your employees and this new team that's coming together.
Commissioner Reinhart.
And I assume that you have reached out to the other police departments across the county. And so is everybody on board? I would hope so, because it sounds absolutely amazing, and I really appreciate also the six-month overlap so that we make sure that everyone is covered until we're up to full speed on it. But tell me about the other departments.
Mr. Chairman and Commissioner, so our plan is to start where St. Paul, that's where most of the where the activity was taken with law enforcement. So much like we did with the mental health contract and sexual assault services, then we'll begin to have conversations with each one of the local law enforcement jurisdictions about their desire to co-respond with us. We don't see as many removals in other cities, but we do see them. So yes, the next conversation is with all the other law enforcement agencies. Let them know that this is available to them, that we can co-respond. It will be available to every law enforcement agency across our county. We just started with St. Paul just because of the sheer number of times children were displaced in St. Paul. But that doesn't mean we're precluding any of the other cities. And I'll begin those conversations with the chief of their law enforcement agencies in other cities as well.
So that, Mr. Chair, so that will be done within that six-month transition period, because I assume that they're covered under the cooperative agreement right now.
Mr. Chairman and Commissioner, yes, they are covered under the cooperative agreement because it's all of Ramsey County. And in that intervening time period, we'll get a chance to make all those connections.
Wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you.
Commissioner Carter.
Thank you. Many have noted, and I would just also reinforce that this is so very important because of the difference that it can make when that very first interaction at the time of the occurrence is an appropriate interaction. So with social services responding and knowing how to address circumstances of this sort, our children can have a better trajectory for the future with their families, if at all possible. So thank you again. I also want to just share that this is definitely leadership on behalf of Ramsey County, that as all our counties in Minnesota are getting together and sharing transformative ideas to line up with the Family First Prevention Services Act, scheduled to implement in Minnesota in 2021, toward the middle of 2021, I think. This is an example of the kind of transformation all our counties are looking forward to. And without that Family First Services Prevention Act funding, you know, and support that it provides, you're already aligning those family first kinds of prevention steps that will make the difference and that will be leadership as we all evolve toward Family First in 2021.
thank you so much for your extreme leadership of social services and child services in Minnesota. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner.
Commissioner McGuire.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just want to thank you as well for this great work, and just to echo Commissioner Reinhart's question, and just to let you know that our suburban communities are really looking for this partnership as well. I know that there aren't as many numbers as you have said, but they are looking for greater partnership with our health department in this area, but also in mental health and in other ways. So I'm excited to hear that you're going to be reaching out to them.
And Mr. Chair, if I could just make one more comment, sort of from a couple of different views across the health and wellness service team, we are now co-responding or moving toward a co-responder model. We are in sexual assault services, we are in mental health, and now we will be in child protection. And I just think it's a great partnership, and we're playing our roles and taking on our responsibilities. So it's really, I don't know how many of the total police calls that is, but that's quite a few. And so I'm just really proud of this work across the entire health and wellness service team.
And Ann, before you run off, I just want to do a brief call out in all our work that we've been doing in transitioning our county to one county, one mission, one door, and really recognizing the importance of community engagement and where equity fits in this. When your first sentence in your lead-in to the update to the board was, "We listen to community." That was the first sentence you led with, and I appreciate that, and I just want to call that out. Thank you.
Thanks
for all the good work, and pass that along to everybody who's worked on this. And I'm not sure what's next for co-responding, but I'm sure there's some other stuff we got to do better in.
Thank you.
All right. Roll call, please.
Carter.
Yes.
Matas Castillo.
Yes.
McGuire.
Aye.
Ortega.
Aye.
Reinhart.
Aye.
McDonough.
Aye. So, Commissioner Carter, if it's all right, you've pulled like four, I think, here that are all connected.
Yes.
And so if we could just make a motion to move all three, like the administrative agenda, then we can flow between them as
indeed.
You.
Indeed. Thank you. So,
we start with 13.
I'd like to move 13, 14, and 15.
And do we have a second? All right. Commissioner Carter.
Thank you. I just appreciate the opportunity to ask our Workforce Solutions Director, Ling Becker, to come forward. We have we're working toward approving the submission of our 2020 and 2021 MFIP Investment Program Biennial Service Agreement with the state of Minnesota. We have in number 14 the opportunity to approve the selection of agreements for our MFIP program, and in number 15, a sole source agreement. I just want to ask Ling Becker to talk about this particular area of services, because we have been looking at whole services for the community, and particularly a focus on culturally appropriate services in communities of color. I so much appreciate the work that has been done over a couple of years now refining this work, and would like to ask you to just share what we've achieved here as we move this forward.
Yeah, Mr. Chair, good morning, commissioners. Thank you for the opportunity to provide an update regarding this request for board action, or this group of board actions. As you recall, first of all, I want to thank our staff. We've worked really hard over these last few months to get this all put together, but also to the community-based partners for their patience and their support of the work to recalibrate around the work that we're going to be talking about here today. As you recall, the RFP process for our MFIP services actually started in April of 2018. That RFP was canceled due to some concerns to look at the minimum qualifications for vendors through a lens of equity. This new RFP that was actually released in May of this year involved a lot of relooking at the components to ensure that we could best serve people of color and Native Americans in our community who are experiencing the deepest disparities in our systems. The action before you has the county contracting out 60% of our MFIP cases. In addition, I've been personally very involved in working with our partners for equity and will continue to do so to ensure that the resources allocated are done so in a way that supports our shared goals with our community partners of improving these outcomes of these families. Part of this also included this CLUE sole source, because we actually did not receive a Latino responder, but because of their strong response in the previous RFP, we invited them back in to be a provider in this service. Our equity components in this model are have an increase in funding of 102% over the last funding model. So it really is a big transformational shift for our work. By no means, the work is not done. We continue to push ourselves to improve economic and employment outcomes through the way we deliver services, who we're partnering with and aligning with families in meaningful work and living wage jobs. One of our equity partners sent me a note not that long ago saying they see the county with this RFP as a true partner in the work, and that our actions in creating this model validate the stories and feedback that they've been hearing from their communities. And that email meant a lot to me. Last week at the SIA cohort, there was a comment made. It said that we're aiming as a county changing our work from being more less transactional and more transformational. I believe that your action today gets us on the path for that. And the work is just continuing and just starting, really. So,
Thank you.
Yeah.
Commissioner Carter.
Just to follow on, and SIA is St. Paul Indians in Action.
Yes.
I just want to underscore that just as our last comments related to the health and wellness team and listening to the community, this work that you're bringing forward today illustrates great acumen in listening to and responding to our community. Thank you so much.
And I do want to call out, even with the best intentions, we are not perfect. And this really demonstrates that we can catch that and we can adjust and we can admit that we need to go back and do better. And I appreciate the work that's been done, because certainly this is a good example, and we'll continue to have great intentions but not always getting it right. And the important piece is to making sure that we're catching ourselves and we're responding and we're showing to the community that we are committed to this. So, Ling, to you and all the folks that have worked on this through the county manager's office. I know the county attorney's office had to get involved in all this because this was complex in making this correction, but really the benefit to the community and to us in Ramsey County is being demonstrated here today. So thank you for all
that.
Yeah,
thank you, Mr. Chair. I would just say one more thing, which is, you know, this really, the work is really just beginning in my eyes. This is a great start. We've recalibrated, but we've committed to our partners to really commit to that community engagement. We have a full staff of a team of 8 redoing our whole community engagement plan around workforce solutions. And also we're creating a whole data team, because we know that there's just a lot that we need to be shifting, but we don't always have all those pieces to be able to do that. And so we're gonna be going out of the gate even with a new RFP, knowing with an eye of continuous improvement as we go about the work, so.
Excellent.
Yeah, thank you.
Commissioner Reinhart.
We don't often give a round of applause on agenda items, but I really think it's deserved in this case.
You lead us. Well done.
Thank you.
Yep. Roll call.
Carter.
Yes.
Matas Castillo.
Yes.
McGuire.
Aye.
Ortega.
Aye.
Reinhart.
Aye.
McDonough.
Aye. Next up is our policy item from the County Manager, Ramsey County and Greater MSP Vision, Partnership, and Relationship, County Manager Ryan O'Connor.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
And come on up, Peter.
Come on down. Your presentation will be on that computer right there. And I'll give a few opening comments, Mr. Chair. This is a moment of joint comments from Mr. Frosch and I. We've talked for a while about bringing in Greater MSP under the new leadership of Peter Frosch to talk about the partnership between Ramsey County and the region and Greater MSP. And as a part of the conversation when we first sat down, I'll say that in the opening comments, the offer on the table was, we can do that simple thing where you come and say, I love Ramsey County, it's great to be in the region, happy to be here, and we all nod, and then we go home, or we could do something and dig a little bit deeper. And to Peter's credit, he said, I don't know why we would do the first, let's dig deeper. So over the course of the last number of months, with the help of Elizabeth Tolsman and Matt Lewis, who you'll see later on today as we keep going forward, we dug into how do we have a conversation that goes deeper today about our partnership and the importance of Greater MSP in our work and the importance of Ramsey County in the region's work. And to that end, we're gonna talk a little bit about the leadership high-level piece here first, and Peter's gonna lay out some of that guiding North Star principles that matter to both organizations and where we wanna go. Then as we transition downstairs to a workshop, Elizabeth and Matt are going to take a larger role and talk about how we're measuring progress. I mean, how do our community indicators and our performance measures align with the work of Greater MSP to measure and what that looks like? And then after lunch today, we're going to come back and get hyper-focused on Ramsey County, specifically in economic development and workforce solutions, and talk about all of the opportunities here to drive our work through that lens of both local leadership and regional collaboration. And so I just want to give credit to Peter and the entire Greater MSP team for really opening their arms and their minds around this conversation. It's been exciting to plan, and I look forward to a productive day of conversation about these important topics together.
Welcome, Peter.
Excellent. Thank you. You have an ambitious day ahead of you on a big election day. Thank you for the time to be with you today. I was just thinking about coming before you this morning, recognize that many of us have been now working together for 13 years in some cases, going back to the Washington days. And at that time, it was you all who had come together to create Greater MSP. So Ramsey County is a founding investor and partner and leader in this regional partnership to grow the economy and strengthen the community. I just want to recognize that, and it's an honor to now help lead this partnership, and I look forward to stewarding this endeavor that you helped create. We have good news about where we are in the status of this effort. I mean, over the past several years, by working together, we have found what the regional work is that we have to do, and that wasn't actually clear. We didn't really start with a playbook in this region. Doing this work in the Minneapolis-St. Paul region is actually quite a bit different, we found, than doing it in many other places in the country, where there's one big city, and there's one big county, and in some cases, there's one big kind of sector of the economy. Here, there are many counties, and many cities, and many sectors. And so this is really an all-in effort. But together, we've identified what the kind of functional, what the work of this partnership is. We want to work together to track the performance of the economy. How are we doing? When we started 6, 7, 8 years ago, there were very different answers to that question. And if we can't answer that question, we're not going to get very far. And we were actually debating who we were competing against. And so I remember when I was starting and we were having these conversations, and the same day, people would be talking about Singapore and they'd be talking about Sioux Falls. And it was really hard to hold together a conversation about how are we really doing. And so together we set that that group of aggressive U.S. peers. We now know how we're doing. We're going to talk about that this afternoon in terms of the region. We know how to index Ramsey County against that, and it's important to track performance. Then you have to know what you're going to do. You have to have a strategy. Before we started this work together, the region didn't have a strategy. You know, we didn't have one clear view of what do we need to do together. I'm just listening this morning. The county has many responsibilities, right? And some of them, increasingly like affordability and transportation and mobility and racial inclusion and innovation and talent, are beyond the boundaries of any county or any city or any organization to actually totally fulfill alone. And that's the work that we have to do together strategically. And you all know that it's really about execution. You were just having an execution conversation on workforce. And so that's really exciting news. Over the last several years, we have really learned how to actually come together with a little increment of additional investment and some great staff at GRMSP to align and drive hundreds of organizations, including Ramsey County. And the results are really adding up. So that's one of the top lines for 2019. 2019 seems to be the year that so much of this work really came together at scale. And that's really one of the big ideas of GRMSP, that we're not only having a breadth of intervention, but we're actually getting solutions at scale. So we wanted to tell the story to talented workers across this country. This year, we're touching 1.75 million workers in dozens of markets across this country in a very targeted way, you know, based on geography and sector and occupation. And those are the folks that we need to add to our economy, because of course we need to develop everybody we've got, we need to retain the talent we have, and we need to bring more to be a part of this work. We're also working on retaining professions of color in a way that, you know, we're finally getting to real scale. We created together this toolkit through BMSP, the Make It MSP initiative, and over 300 organizations in the region are now using this toolkit, which was co-created by dozens of leaders across this community to improve workplace inclusion, which is critically important. So that's an asset that the county could be actually using potentially as an employer, in addition to all the employers in this region. We're seeing a real impact in the startup and innovation work that's launched this year. Together, we can be all around the country and the world in a way that none of us could be alone. So an example of that, you know, through the Startup and Innovation Work Forge North, we were at Collision, which is a big North American conference in Toronto. We brought several of the leading startups in this market, and one of those startups got connected with an Indian investor and has, as of last week, inked a $5 million investment deal, which is going to allow a startup in this community to sell into the Indian market. And so these are the kinds of like big scale things that are happening now, kind of week by week, month by month, you know, through this partnership. I would also suggest that not only have we found the work of the region, we've actually found the work that the region and the county have to do together. And so this is a short list of some of the things that we are now doing together. We've created structures that didn't exist before that allow city and county and private sector partners to come together and solve problems, see the problems. One of those structures being the East Team of the Center Cities Initiative. Ramsey County has been a part of this for a number of years, getting Hennepin and Ramsey, and the cities of St. Paul, Minneapolis, and the St. Paul Chamber, the Minneapolis Chamber, and the Port Authority together, thinking about how we really focus on urban economic development. We know it's different for practice, and we've also learned that a lot of the economic development work is actually within St. Paul in the east side and within Minneapolis and the west side. And so we built a team called the East Team, which Ramsey County is a leader in, where we're sharing real-time information, where we're talking about the riverfront development, and we're talking about the Central Station site, and we're talking about the Midway Stadium site. And we're having that as one conversation and thinking about how we can solve a number of problems together so those all go not only faster, but we get the full opportunity from those areas. I think we're going to talk a lot today about workforce. And so coming together through the Greater Metropolitan Workforce Council has been a really important step we've taken together. That's a structure that didn't exist. Like everything else we're doing at a regional scale, it wasn't immediately clear how we were going to make that work, but because of the dedication of a lot of great leaders, we are, including Commissioner Carter and others, we are figuring out, you know, week by week and month by month, how we better serve the needs of the two kind of customers of workforce, job-seeking residents and employers who need workers. And so this is a modernization effort. We know that the people we are changing, the economy has very significantly changed, it's changing really fast. To be effective, you know, in government and in the private sector, we've got to learn how to run at the speed of the economy, and we're figuring that out. And there are many other ways that we are, I think, just beginning to partner in these areas. I want to talk a little briefly about the kind of leverage. So very conservatively, the commitment of Ramsey County financially to the Grimsby Partnership is leveraged 50 times. It's a 50x at least investment. This is a true public-private partnership. This is not a full list of the private sector partners involved. But I know in government we talk a lot about how can we work together with the private sector? How can we really get the business community engaged? It's happening. The business community is engaged. We've identified with the business community these areas of shared interest, and we have a mechanism of going after those things. And so this is a cross-sector partnership, and that's very unique. And it's hard. Right? You know that it's hard, but it's really important. And now, you know, over the last several years, we've seen enough traction and results that we see real buy-in, and we see a growth in this partnership, especially on the private sector side. So the last point I'll just make about where we're going next, something we've learned is it's time to really get clear on where we're all trying to go with goals, right? We've measured the economy, and by doing that, we said we need some goals. And then we started putting a strategy together and said the strategy needs goals. And now that we're executing at scale with the Greater Metropolitan Workforce Council, Make It MSP, and Forge North, all the partners are saying we really need a clear view of what we're trying to produce together. And so that is a really important effort that the county can and needs to play a leadership role on right now. I mean, this is where the county can really put a hand on the rudder and say, as we look out to 2030, what is the place that we need to become? And some of us were in Boston recently. for the inner city leadership visit. I think that was a real wake-up call about the importance of thinking ahead and about recognizing that we have to work on our priorities in parallel. You know, if we focus on job growth and innovation to the exclusion of things like transportation and mobility and affordability and even climate resilience, we can't create sustainable long-term growth and prosperity. So it's not a menu. I mean, this is the 21st century challenge. You know, it's a connected solve. But through this partnership, we've created some mechanisms to do that. So I look forward to a dialogue, answering any questions you have, and then getting into more detail this afternoon.
Great. Thank you. Any questions or comments? Commissioner Reinhart.
Well, I have just really enjoyed this journey that we've been on for the last few years. The reinvention is really what it comes down to. And I so appreciate your leadership. You're doing a great job. And just the evolution of what has happened with greater MSP and the recognition on, in all of the areas that you listed are so very, very critical. And it's great to see also activity, for example, in the complete count, the census, the complete count committees, and the interaction with what Ramsey County and St. Paul, and I'm assuming other jurisdictions are doing as well, from greater MSP, because clearly the numbers make a difference in representation, but they also make a difference when it comes to funding that comes in through the federal government and other entities to be able to show the diversity and the wealth of knowledge that we have here in the metro area. And that recognition is really noticed, and I appreciate that. And then finally, just as you have pointed out so eloquently, the focus on equity in everything that we're doing is obviously near and dear to our hearts because of the journey that we're on as well in making changes, systemic changes, mm-hmm. And how that's been incorporated into greater MSP. So it's not, when we think about economic development, oftentimes it's, and the chambers do a great job. I mean, there's so many entities that are involved with it, but it's, I think, a new phase that everyone is going through to really intentionally mm-hmm. make a difference so that everyone mm-hmm. is engaged, everyone is involved, everyone mm-hmm. is valued. Mm-hmm. And that has to be intentional. That's what we do, and that's what Greater MSP is doing as well. So I just wanted to recognize that and your leadership in getting us to this point.
Thank you.
Mr. McGuire.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I also want to thank you for your leadership, Mr. Fresh. It's great to see you in this capacity. Just could you talk a little bit about the cooperation with, you mentioned all the partners and everything that you have and that we need all those partners, with East Metro Strong and your East Metro mm-hmm. team that you mm-hmm. talked about with greater MSP. I mean, we definitely want a greater MSP vitality, but then just talk about the East Metro Strong with your East Metro team.
You know, I think that is something that's coming into view as a real opportunity, yeah. You know, in 2020 and beyond. Something that we've collectively identified strategically is that affordability, mobility, and kind of climate resilience are just core competitive factors. They're not nice to have quality of life elements, and the people saying that are corporate leaders and private sector leaders. And now that we have that transportation and mobility on the board as one of the 9 kind of focus priorities for this region, it's going to allow us to bring and invite new kind of partners table and put positive pressure on us to be solving these things in a new way. So we would like to have that conversation with East Metro Strong and the East team. And it starts with a conversation. I don't think we're running to believe that we know exactly what the solutions look like. But the reason we say mobility is we're not just saying transportation, right? There are some questions about what it is to get around. What systems do we need? What systems can we afford? You know, and what does technology allow us to do? Because to Commissioner Reinhart's previous point, we're experiencing a transformation. Mm-hmm. And I think the more that we embrace that, the more successful we're going to be in Ramsey County and in this region and in the state. And so Ling's point is well taken. I mean, we're talking more and more. I mean, transactions matter. You know, it's projects and transactions every day and every month that drive change. But what are we aiming for? You know, the strategic intent of transformation, because we're different people in a different economy. And so the systems we built in another time for another economy are not surprisingly going to underperform today. And that's okay. Mm-hmm. But this is hard. Change is hard. People don't love change. And so I think, as you know, one of the things that we can do together through this partnership, we have this capability to negotiate this change, see the future together, try some new things. And then when we find something that works, kind of come together as partners and say, it's time to scale that. There are going to be some choices around the corner about things that used to work and things that now work better. And we, as a community, as a partnership, want to support you as leaders in Ramsey County to drive some of that transition.
Excellent. Commissioner Mattis Castile?
Yeah, I just wanted to ask kind of in this line of, as you're going down this path and this journey and identifying where we can go, have you found some low-hanging fruit? You know, are there some easy steps that we can make to move this trajectory along a little further, faster? Now, change is hard and it's slow and relationships take time, but I feel a sense of urgency often. So I'm wondering if there's, you know, some things that we can do that would be, you know, catapult us maybe.
Right. Yes. I mean, one, the reason that we're really focused on creating some of these goals and getting really clear on our priorities is because that helps us understand what we should really be focused on. It puts pressure on that moment. So in this partnership, we have the chance of working on the short term and the medium and the long term. And so we don't, those aren't choices. Those are actually things that we're thinking about in parallel. The short term opportunities we found are when we bring leaders together, we're convinced that it's time to do something new, that they have the opportunity to win for their organization bigger if they work with someone else, and they're kind of appropriately humble about what they know or don't know in that moment, and then big, exciting things happen. And we see that pattern happening across the talent work and the innovation work. For example, there are more than a dozen small entrepreneurial support organizations in this region that are driven usually by one or two or maybe three people, bootstrapped, hardworking folks, and most entrepreneurs don't know any of these things exist. And so together through this Forge North ecosystem, what we're able to do is create this Compass project, where if you're an entrepreneur, you can go to forgenorth.org, I'm looking for this help, and then it tells you who to call. Nice. Right? And it conveys value to everyone who's doing that work. Without that shared kind of project, none of that happens. Another example is in the talent retention attraction work. We are now on campus. We went to Madison this fall. We were at Michigan State this fall. And we're telling the story of this place. We're listening to students. And we're actually collecting some generational insight, which we look forward to sharing with you. Because what we're hearing from Gen Z is a little bit different than even what we were hearing from the millennial generation. And it's really important for you to know. This is a very young county. And it's important to understand who residents are today and where the economy is going. But there are many instances of these kind of exciting moments of explosion. The East team, there are a couple of examples with a pitch book that we're putting together. And the Downtown Alliance has been working to create a brand. Greater Mississippi and Ramsey County and the city of St. Paul have some real insight on sites. We said, well, we could put together very quickly, for very little money, a pitch book that all of the leaders could be carrying around the country, and that we could be using both digitally and kind of in person to raise the visibility of the economic opportunity that exists in St. Paul and Ramsey County. Alone, that was probably never going to happen. Together, you know, we're doing it in a matter of a few months.
Commissioner Carter.
Thank you. I would like to just say thank you so much also, Peter, for the consistency of Greater MSP, but yourself at the table in the various initiatives. The portfolio that you shared represents a number of places where leaders come together from multiple sectors, and particularly in the Greater Metropolitan Workforce Council, where all of our sectors at the table together, be it government or education or business or economic development or the nonprofits and community organizations together at the table need to move forward. You have been a consistent presence and a consistent encouragement for the work that we need to do together across sectors. Sometimes we're very, very different from each other, and sometimes even competitive
with each other, but in the end, our commonalities, and in particular, our common challenges and opportunities, must bring us together for the future. And as you look at the initiatives that you've shared, and you talk about short-term, mid-term, long-term, give us an idea of how Greater MSP perceives those mm-hmm. initiatives in the portfolio mm-hmm. over the short, middle, and long term. Mm-hmm. Do you perceive that these are for the next 20 years or mm. that, you know, our achievements might be accomplished in one or the other within the first two and right. go away, be replaced? What are your thoughts on and how is Greater MSP teeing those up?
Appreciate the question. I think one of the things that we've learned is we have to take a dynamic approach. I mean, if we're focused on the economy and how the economy works, then we have to be prepared to shift as conditions shift. That said, we know here at the end of 2019 that affordability, mobility, racial inclusion, job growth, regional image, these are going to be critically important in the coming decade. We know that to be true. And so what we figured out together is we're going to set these ambitions at a 10-year scale, and then we'll create 3-year goals in each of these areas, and we'll drive towards those goals, recognizing that kind of 3 years at a time, there's going to be change. The economic cycle is going to change. We're going to learn how to do new things. Some of this is going to go faster than we think. Some of this is going to go slower than we think. So some things that I thought were going to be transactional 4 years ago turned out to be transformational, and we're still at them. Yeah. But that's where some of the most exciting work happens. I'd highlight, you asked about the initiatives, Connext MSP, which is something that some of you may have heard about because we've been talking about it. I think this is what in that kind of medium-term transformational space. So the idea, you know, kind of to the low-hanging fruit opportunity, 14 college and career readiness programs. They exist all across this metro. Many students participate in more than one. It's really great to get a kind of real-world work experience when you're still in high school. But that's really the beginning, right? That should be the start of something, not the end of something. So this idea of Connext MSP, which is something that came out of the philanthropic community and the corporate community, is that that would be a pipeline. That if you graduate, if you do as a student what you're being asked to do in any of those programs, you become part of a community of opportunity, that there's something special for you that you get to be a part of that, you know, and that may not have previously been the case. We're talking about 60 to 80,000 students have gone through these 14 programs in the last 8 to 10 years. This is a huge opportunity. So when we talk about transformation, I mean, this is how we solve our, you know, worker challenge. This is how we get at racial inclusion and wealth building in communities. And it's not easy and it's not going to happen in 1 year. But we've built a digital platform together. We've got thousands of students now on this platform. And we want to connect that high school to higher ed to full-time employment experience. And this is going to be a huge opportunity to work with Ramsey County and start this connection between the private sector and community. We've got some strong theories about what's going to work and not going to work, but this is going to be a rich space for experimentation because when we make this work, it's going to be really big and it's going to take a few years.
Thank you. All right, Peter, as we wrap this up and continue the conversation downstairs on a deeper dive on the workforce partnership, as you were talking a few, first off, I publicly want to congratulate you on it's. I know it's been a number of months now since you've taken on the leadership role, but publicly congratulate you on that and well earned. And we look forward to working with you personally, but with the organization. And I had a couple of memories come up. I can remember when we actually approved joining Greater MSP. I think we were the first public entity, if maybe the second. But it was important to get that template right. And I got called out, and I was talking with Kathy Schmidtkoffer, who was leading the effort there as we were finalizing the last details with the attorneys on this public-private partnership and setting that template. But my biggest recollection, and you've mentioned a lot of our East Metro, St. Paul, Ramsey County, is almost 4 years ago to the date, we were celebrating on a Friday a number of your staff what we thought was going to be a deal on the thumb up at mm-hmm. Rice Creek Commons on a major expansion from an organization that hadn't a presence in our community. And we were heading off to the intercity leadership visit at Seattle that time, and the first day of that visit, there was lots of congratulate going on. But by the second day of that visit, we had notification that that company had been taken over. Yeah. And the first thing that the new company did was put a halt to all expansion plans. But I do want to call out that we still have a thumb up there ready for any organization that wants to expand in our community. And we're looking forward to partnering with you and your team on that opportunity, or hopefully sooner rather than later.
Well, thank you so much. I look forward to the discussion, and like the, maybe the last point would be just to reinforce this idea. We own this together. This is something that we created, and now the encouragement going forward that we have this capability is I encourage you to think about how you can use the Grimsby partnership to test things, solve problems, working with others at a regional scale, because you know it's meant to be co-created. So great. Thank you.
Thanks for being here. All right. Before I move on to County Connections from County Manager Ryan O'Connor, as you can see, we have got a jam-packed day. So I'm going to ask everybody if we keep our updates to one or two items, and I promise next week we've got more time. We can catch up where we need to catch up on those updates, but trying to keep us on schedule here so we can make sure we have enough time for all the other things on our agenda. So with that, Ryan O'Connor, County Connections.
Well, at least there's been nothing going on this week, Mr. Chair.
There's always one or two things here.
Perfect. If I can do a quick introduction first, I'll invite her up as I begin to introduce her. I just wanted to introduce Deanna Pesek, our new Chief Compliance and Ethics Officer to Ramsey County. This was a part of the compliance office that you all as a board approved earlier this year as a part of a three-position unit, and Deanna's first day was last week, and I wanted to bring her in to say hi, and if she could just share a few words about herself briefly.
Welcome.
Thank you. you have to excuse me, I'm losing my voice a bit. I've been talking quite a bit in the last 7 days. First of all, I just wanted to thank all of you for having this vision that's become the Chief Compliance and Ethics Office. It's really exciting to me to have a role in county government that I've been doing in so many multinational companies internationally. I kind of chuckled when he mentioned, I think it was Sioux City versus Singapore. I lived in Singapore for the past 11 years. I just moved here to Minnesota a year ago. With my family, so it's been quite an adjustment, both adjusting to being in. Thank you so much. Yes. Sorry, it's been quite an adjustment for us. The weather, one, and being back in the U.S. after being away so long. But again, this is a role that I have performed in multinationals, mostly internationally, but I think that the way that it's been structured, the vision that both you and Ryan had for it is very similar to the other roles I've performed, at Visa, at Yahoo, at Volvo Group. So I'm super excited, and I have to say that I'm very impressed with the initiatives that you've put in place, and it makes me feel comfortable that I think the organization's moving in the right direction. For instance, the diversity and inclusion seems to have gone further than just a statement. I've seen, it was for me personally, seeing representation at every level of the recruitment process was quite encouraging and comforting both. Excuse me, sorry. So I look forward to meeting each of you at some point, hopefully, and just getting a sense of how you see the role evolving, and further just letting you know who I am and what my vision is for the role as well. So thank you.
Congratulations and welcome to the team.
And so, Mr. Chair, we'll make sure that Deanna finds her way around, and she'll be heavily involved with the county attorney's office, with the Center of Excellence, with Emily Colby and her role in the risk register about how we move forward on a robust compliance and ethics program across the organization. Items I'm not going to speak more to. You got an email this week about Long Lake Regional Park and the ice castles coming there. Check your email for that. Also, we did a full emergency stand-up test of our emergency communication center. What happens if it were to go down and Dakota County had to pick up our calls? I'll cut it short by just saying it all went really well, and we had a seamless transition in case that kind of a moment happened. On Water Gremlin, there's been a ton of information going on. There were 300 families impacted last week by the state's regulatory decision to temporarily close Water Gremlin. They are open as of this morning after a full day of compliance-related training yesterday around lead practices. There's additional work going on, and there's a lot of uncertainty that remains, both across the community, even for our own agencies, but also for the families, most importantly, for the 300 workers of that organization and their families. The lead testing results have not fully come back yet. That's going to be happening over the coming days. Public health has been taking a leadership role in ensuring that we're talking to the Minnesota Department of Health on what happens. Our WIC clinics are becoming the on-the-ground logistics site now in terms of our work both with workforce and with public health. I'll just thank public health, workforce solutions, our mental health center through social services, Parks and Rec, the county attorney's office, and property management. These departments stepped up last week, and it saw why connections on the ground matter when you're dealing with community. We saw why an integrated response across this organization matters, and we saw why leadership across our organization matters. To finish out here on two last pieces on immigration services, you know that last year you approved funding for immigration services, both wraparound and with legal service providers. The Vera Institute of Justice is the organization that ultimately was leading the RFP process then for us. They have selected three vendors. You'll be getting more information about that in an email today from Elizabeth Tolsman, but the Immigrant Law Center of Minnesota, Advocates for Human Rights, and the Mid-Minnesota Legal Center are the three organizations that were selected by Vera. Again, more to come, really exciting announcement. And finally, I'm gonna leave you with a great quote today. Kevin Williams was a planning specialist too with Ramsey County, and I say was because I think his last day was last week. He got a new exciting opportunity in California. That's what happens with good leaders sometimes. But right before he left, he was a part of the Leadership St. Paul program from representing Ramsey County. We've had a number of representatives over the year go to this program. And he was nominated by his colleagues or selected by his colleagues to deliver one of the graduation speeches. And so he had sent it to us along with a thank you about his time with Ramsey County. And Kevin's been transformative in a lot of our work. But there was one part where I said, Kevin, can I just read what you wrote and share it with the board? And he said yes. So I'm going to leave you with this thought from Kevin today. As we look back over our last year, we have identified system obstacles. We have seen gaps. We have been faced with system inefficiencies and been challenged by outcomes that don't favor progress. However, it is our ability to see a different future that brought us to this cohort, to this moment. We are the champions of tomorrow and the visionaries of today. We were selected by our organizations because they can see the statues within our marble. The fate of the world might not rest on our shoulders. Maybe it does. But we are not here by accident. We must live in our leadership and in our intentionality. We are the dreams of our ancestors.
Wow. Thank you. Commissioner Carter.
Okay, you gave me a quota, and I don't know if I can make it. If I don't mention these things, I won't think of them next week. We didn't have a meeting last week, so let me just quickly see if I can give a shout-out to the St. Paul Area Chamber of Commerce for their Equity Summit 2, which was held in St. Paul. A focus on equity with Pillsbury House Theater presenting a wonderful scenario that I hope at some point we get to see here. Our Criminal Justice Coordinating Committee met with its focus on fines and fees and bail reform. Thank you to the members of the community that come together with our system partners there. Attended the League of Women Voters centennial event at the Union Depot a weekend and a half ago. It was a wonderful event, and I was pleased to share the honor with a number of women of color, Minnesota First. Cleveland Avenue Reconstruction Project had an open house, amazing consensus on the construction of that avenue, and really a lot of great work that's gone into that by our Public Works Department. Last but not least, we had our adult and child foster care dinner. A number of us were there. And shout out and appreciation to all of the folks who came together there, including Judge Hilders, who gave what I understand was a very thoughtful presentation. I was actually at the Ramsey County League of Local Governments at the same time. And so that's it. I'm passing it on.
Commissioner McGuire.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chair. And I have lots of things to be talking about, and I appreciate we'll get to talk even more next week. But just a few things. We had a great bonding tour, and many of us were there, where the Minnesota Management and Budget Office came in, looked at our proposals, and that was a great event. And then we had a great meeting with Representative Carlos Mariani yesterday on public safety issues. And I just want to say that we're starting those conversations with our legislators and our executive branch on our upcoming legislative agenda. And just to, I know this, we all know it's election day today, and we have an election going on in District 1 of our county board. So just everyone in District 1, please go vote today for our 7th member of our board. And we have a community visioning meeting going on tonight at 70 County Road B2, and it's from 5:30 to 7:30, where people can come in and tell us what their vision is. And I know there's others going on. I just know that one is this week, and maybe there's one Friday night,
Thursday.
Too. There, Thursday night. Thursday. There's another one Thursday night.
Central.
Thank you for that. And there's a Roseville Area Schools Fun Run and Walk this Saturday at Emma D. Williams from 9 to 12. And that is all the upcoming, that is some of the upcoming things. I can talk about the other events next week. So
thank you.
Thank you for that.
Commissioner Ortega.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'd like to give a shout out to Casa Esperanza, who last week celebrated their first anniversary of their education and training center. And I also attended the swearing in of Judge Alagada, our newest member to the bench. And Reggie's going to be a great addition to our bench. So I was there on behalf of the board to welcome him. Great.
Thank you. Commissioner Reinhart.
Okay. Speed.
I know. Right. Speed.
Okay, the legislative.
You guys are doing great.
The legislative bonding tour was great, covering all sorts of things in Ramsey County and St. Paul. And this time I was on the bus and able to talk about things in between as well. But boy, it was cold out there. Anyhow, one of the other things, because it has been 2 weeks, that I participated in was a tour at the Evergreen plant. District Energy I'm going to get this right. It's not wood waste. It is wood as an energy resource. And it also is really assisting not only with energy and district heating and cooling, but also with the issue of emerald ash borer and diseased trees, which is becoming a huge issue. And this is an option, and we have no other options for it, really. And so hopefully we'll get that taken care of. We have to do it this legislative session. The complete count committee met, and there's a lot of activity that's bumping up, so we're going to be meeting monthly. I attended the Greater MSP Board of Directors, and again, a robust conversation about these goals and how we're moving forward. I also attended the AMC District 10 meeting and had I loved the way we are doing things now, the information and then an exercise on, okay, now you've got all the information, how would you recommend funding it? And came up with some really creative ideas on how to do that for transit and transportation. I also participated in the Battle Creek Regional Park Community Design Forum on Saturday morning. And I know that Joanne Ellis was there from Commissioner McDonough's office as well. And a great turnout and a lot of good conversation. Finally, regarding Water Gremlin and everything that's going on there, it's not just that they went through training yesterday, but the company also has a number of things that were recommended and are going to be implemented regarding making sure that the workers are safe and that their families are safe going into the future. But we still have to deal with what we're happening right now. And just so I know that everybody is aware of it, but lead was the most recent thing, the TCE, DTCE, and the solvents that they use, and what had happened there over the last 17 years, and potential legislation moving forward. There was a forum on TCE and legislation a week ago Saturday, and again, very well attended legislators that were there talking about what we need to do to ban TCE.
in Minnesota. The final thing that I will bring up is the Landmark Gala this Saturday, the 19th.
Friday.
Yeah, that would have been bad. On Friday, I'm sure that there are probably tickets still available. Go and check it out. This year, this time it is the 1960s. And I'm ready.
I have a costume.
So do I. Anyhow, it's so much fun, and it's to benefit a true gem in our, not just our county and our city, but our state. And so hopefully people will come and enjoy. Thank you.
Thank you. Commissioner Mattis Castillo.
Awesome. I will be really quick as well. We had a great Rice Lavender Harvest Festival on Sunday this week at the Rice Street Gardens on the Maplewood side. So that tri-city partnership is going very well. They're bringing community together and activating those spaces. And then I want to give a shout out to Public Works. Public Works held two open houses in my district in the last week or so around the Cleveland Avenue redesigned. Incredible turnout. I mean, I have not, the Falcon Heights City Hall was full of people engaging in what does road design and connectability to our communities look like. And then doing really great community, culturally specific, focused outreach around the redesign of Rice Street, which has been something that has been needed to be done for several years, but really a great partnership. There were at least six different staff members available that could speak different languages to reach the folks that were there, a really good turnout as well. So really kudos to Public Works for that community engagement so that we get that design right. And then I just want to also do a shout out. Our Transforming Systems Together, though it's in this budget cycle to be approved, is already at work and live here in the county, and I'm seeing it in multiple departments. We had a situation that was in the newspaper this week about some gentlemen that went through tax forfeiture because of taxes, but we had county departments, city departments, and community leaders coming together around how do we transform systems together so that people who are impacted by policies or designs or caught in loopholes, that we can do it better. And so I want to give a shout out to Chris Samuels, who has been working diligently to do outreach in the tax department and assessor's offices differently, and it's not a usual process, but he's working with social services, Max Holhulden, who's doing our homeless services. Everyone is involved, and it is really awesome to see our county employees embrace Transforming Systems Together. And so I just want to say thank you to all involved and our county employees in doing that work.
Good. Thank you. Good work. All right. As soon as we adjourn, we're going to move into a regional rail authority meeting. Immediately after that, we'll move downstairs to room 220 for our workshop, Ramsey County Greater MSP and the Greater Metropolitan Workforce Council Partnership. Immediately after that, we're going to have our lunch and learn in room 220, intercultural development inventory assessment. And then at 1:30, we have our afternoon workshop, community and economic development, workforce solutions, joint update. And after that, I'll be taking a nap.